finally get to meet YAKI KORNBLIT. He was one of the first gallerists in Europe to bring out graffiti writers from New York. And while we were waiting for YAKI to arrive, Miki showed me a lot of old newspaper clippings and flyers from Yaki's gallery days.
Newspaper clippings and press releases, yep. Invitations.
And isn't it great? His wife made the scrapbook for him because he was just working so
the
hard.
The first thing I did was to sit down with Yaki and tell him about our project. And Yaki had brought along Vincent Flasblum, an old partner in his gallery. And Vincent surprised us by bringing an old Rammel C painting from the late 70s, which was amazing, which was like, yeah, it's a document from outer space almost. It was one of the earliest pieces of art that we've seen in the whole research. Vincent was already filming with a video camera back then, and from him we got a lot of nice footage. And my main question to Yaki was, how did you get involved with all these New York artists?
In 82, it was really a beautiful time in the art world, in my sense, like all the what is going on in Germany, the Mülheim and Freiheit, the Berliners, Group Normal, and I was collecting it. But I had connection in New York, because the gallery I was showing conceptual art, like people like Dennis Oppenheim, Peter Hutchinson, and so on and so on. And I went to New York and I rent from a friend of mine. I rented her apartment. And in the sleeping room was a painting, what was intriguing me all the time. And then I asked her, who is this, who made this painting? And she told me Futura 2000. And she asked me, do you want to meet him? I said, of course. And that's how it started. I met first Futura, and we just fell in love with each other whatsoever. And he introduced me to everything, of course. And Dondi and Zephyr, because they were a group. I met all the artists from Rammel Z to Blade, Quick, everybody. He took me to Fashion Moda in the Bronx. I went for 3 weeks to New York and I stayed 8 months in New York to meet all those people, to understand what is going on. And I collected so much work. And I went to Europe on January 83 and the first show was Dondi.
The early invitations for the shows.
So okay. Dondi in January and then Futura in February, Rammel C in March.
By having the shows at his gallery with all these very important artists that had already so much style, the kids here in Amsterdam that were able to visit the gallery show, they got inspired. How can you not be inspired by this type of work?
The most famous Dutch graffiti today, they are the ones who came to each opening in my time, and I introduced them to the artist. There were a group of 7 people who just came to every opening, and they were very nice kids. They were 12, 14, 16, the utmost 16, they think. They were so young, they had to get mature, they had to develop, because here in Europe it was not developed at all. It was big tags, small tags. Let's say, in my eyes, if to compare to New York, it was very primitive.
I think that when those guys came over to Amsterdam, they were a bit surprised that there was so much tagging everywhere. And so that kind of got us a little bit of respect, even though we were younger and obviously at a less advanced stage. So it was a kind of a mix between, we were being colleagues, but also we were younger, so we were kind of pupils.
Chu was just tagging the streets of Amsterdam. And I don't know if he came to one of the exhibitions, but I think as a result of the shows that Yaki was pulling in, And the fact that wherever we stayed, whatever hotel there was, the bus ride or walk to the gallery, we would wind up tagging up on little places and stuff. So that's kind of like the first time we're actually, we got tags running now in your city.
These kids were the time I introduced them to those people, and they just, it was, that stimulated everything. Because the New Yorker went here with these kids from Amsterdam, and they teach them how to spray, and they made beautiful pieces here in the park, everywhere. Quick was everywhere to find. That was the beginning.
There was one moment that I vividly remember. That was a huge Quick throw up, very close to where I lived. And it was gigantic. I mean, we had no idea. We never even contemplated the idea of a fat cap. And this guy, you know, he put outlines with fat caps this thick, like nice and round. And gradually we kind of understood that there was a lot more to it than just, you know, using the can and the spray and cap that's on it when you steal it, and just writing your name very small. There's so many other ways of doing it. And yeah, we all fully went for the New York style of graffiti.
A friend of mine told about this gallery, Yaki, and at that moment he had an exhibition with photos from Henry Chelvin. And then I realized that you could use a can also for surfaces and not just for lines. Almost at the same time, there was an exhibition at the Boijmans van Beuningen Museum in Rotterdam.
And especially this drawing by Rumelzi, S79, crazy. Looked at it for a long time.
Right, so this is my the copy I bought when it came out. Mm. And I will complain.
So actually, Subway Art had a big impact. Book.
So what I did is I took all train numbers, 7670, and I wrote them down. And then I found out that some characters, for instance, I realized that the character here was connected
the same car.
To a car somewhere else, for instance.
I sucked up everything, tried to suck up everything about, yeah, pieces, basically. Yeah, if somebody would go to New York, we would ask them, oh, please take photos. Doesn't matter please where, take photos stuff. And show us the photos.
Yeah, like here, yeah. And actually this little bit here was the inspiration for me, because it looks like the bit next to the two, it looks like it's a step, right? Like a stair. I don't think it was intentionally, but if it means that the 3D goes down and then it becomes a shape again. You know what I mean?
Dondi is, I think, is the best example, because unlike Futura or Ramosi, who were great artists, they weren't really active on trains. And Dondi was actually both. I mean, he really translated the wild style and all the real essence of graffiti to the canvas. And of course, a lot of other writers did that too. But when they all came to Amsterdam, there was a real exchange of ideas and knowledge, really. So that was, you know, all Yaki Kornblit's doing, because he flew them in here and gave them shows. So yeah, that's his part is quite significant.
The change between tagging and piecing happened around 84, and then a lot of people, the old school writers, just stopped. Really, a few just started doing pieces as well. As far as I know, it was only like a handful of people. like me, Shu, Jesus, Joker. You had this guy called Euro. High, of course. There's a few, but not that many.
USA spat alles.
Explosion was 80, 85, 86. And then it just went on exploding. It really took off. If you look back now and you look at all the photos of the whole city being completely bombed, and also this was a time when, you know, the economics weren't that good, so nothing was being cleaned, and a lot of buildings were falling down, even in the center of Amsterdam. It's unimaginable at this moment when you see it now. From 85 on, when the whole, well, I guess we were so influenced by New York, but even much more by Bando and like all these European styles coming out.
It was really interesting to learn more about the graffiti scene in Amsterdam until 1983. At the same time in 1983, Wildstyle made its way to Germany and the UK and created a completely new influence on a generation of kids in those places.